Christ is risen.
You may
be seated. Well, welcome, welcome on this beautiful Easter morning. Happy Resurrection Day to you all. So glad you are here. And we welcome those that will later see this on YouTube. And happy Resurrection Day to them as well. There are a few announcements in your bulletin this morning. It wouldn't be church without a few announcements. Coming up next Saturday is a very fun, Easter doesn't stop on Easter Sunday. We go home, we take off our fancy clothes, but Jesus kept appearing to the disciples. And so next week we're going to celebrate Jesus' resurrection appearance in an Easter make and take for children. So these are sitting on the table. It's also, the information is on your insert. So please take one as you leave if you know someone you think would like to come. What else do I need to tell you this morning? There are flowers by this cross up here on the floor, and they are to go on the cross. So any time in the service where you feel led, just come down and you can cut them and make them shorter. There's scissors on the floor, or you can just put them in full stem and all to celebrate that cross doesn't have Jesus on it and he is alive. And that's just one of the ways we celebrate. Today the children will enjoy an Easter egg hunt during the children's church, but that's not quite yet, so we have to wait a little while. Okay? Just a little while, though. I also want to let you know that I'm going to be gone for the next 2 weeks, actually Tom and I both, and it's part kind of work and part vacation. We're going over to the UK, and I'm going to be visiting with the Reverend Mike Endicott. He does work in Jacob's Well for healing ministry, so we're going to talk about how to use the internet, how to use social media to promote healing ministry, and then we're going to vacation for a week. So would you keep us in your prayers? If you need pastoral care, let one of the session members know, and they'll get in contact with Reverend Vanessa Smith. She'll be filling in my absence for pastoral care. Any other announcements from out here? Bev.
Well, we need all of these faces back next Sunday because in Karen's absence, we're having hymn singing. There's nothing better than lots of voices and.
That's right.
So please return next week for that. And community dinner is a week from Tuesday, and we'd love to have everyone that's here join us. That's going to be a ham dinner, 4:30 to 6:30, and that's the 30th.
That's the 30th, end of the month. That's right. You have to do it without me. I know. I will miss being here for that. Any other announcements? Yes, Sandy.
Well, it was on the screen. John did a good job.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. It's our 25th wedding anniversary. That's part of the reason we're taking a big trip. So. That's okay. Thank you very much. All right. Who's got another hand? Oh, yes, Dorothy. Thank you very much. She sent a beautiful card, which is on the board back there from Haley. She had breast cancer surgery, and she said it went well. You said it went well, and she was just so thankful for the prayer shawl we sent. So our prayers do make a difference. All right, let us pray. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord, for this wondrous day. Thank you that we get invited on this morning to celebrate. We're invited to celebrate every Sunday, but today is especially a celebration. And Lord God, we celebrate you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We celebrate that the amazing, the unexpected, the I can't believe it didn't happen, happened. That this is Resurrection Sunday because Jesus is no longer and will never, ever be dead. We give you praise and thanks even before we sing it again. But Lord, praise you and thank you. May this worship touch your heart, bring you joy, and join us together more and more as one, as your people. In the name of your beloved Son, we do pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing again, 233, this time the Day of Resurrection.
Please be seated. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Powerful and praiseworthy God, our Father, we love this Sunday. We love bunnies, baskets, egg hunts, and Easter brunch, all the many ways to celebrate the resurrection. But we have to admit that our wonder and excitement may not last until Monday. Would you resurrect us, Lord, for life after today? Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. In Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven and invited to believe and live into the resurrection, now in the kingdom of God. Please rise for the Gloria Patri.
You may be seated, unless you'd like to join the choir. Now, would the children like to dance their way down here, and we'll have our children's message. You're sweaty?
I'm sweaty.
I don't know. Are we all going to fit? It's going to be tight. Sneech, gooch, gooch, gooch. But now that you're sitting, I want you to stand up and come over here. We don't usually come back here, do we?
No.
All right. Stay right here. We're not going to go anywhere. Stay right by the door. Okay. What are we looking at?
Easter egg hunt.
This is not the Easter egg hunt. What are we looking at out here? Anybody know what this is?
Graveyard.
A graveyard or a cemetery?
A cemetery.
Yes, it's a cemetery. Okay, do you know where the Easter story started way back on that first Easter day? It started in a cemetery. Did you know that? Yeah. Mary Magdalene and some of the other women, they went to Jesus' tomb. See what these are? These are tombs. That's where they were. And you know what? They're rocks. Yeah, they're rocks over tombs. Underneath them are tombs. And you know what happened when the ladies got there to his tomb? What happened? Was he there?
No.
He wasn't.
He died.
He did, but he wasn't in his tomb.
No, he was sick because he was looking up in a cave.
Yeah, he was in a cave. That's right. It was like a tomb. But you know who was there? Jesus wasn't in that tomb or the cave. An angel was there. Yes. And you know what the angel asked those ladies?
What?
He said, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?"
A bug. I saw a bug.
No, he didn't ask them about bugs. Hold on. He said, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" What did that angel mean?
It means he has to kill and stuff.
He did, but was he still dead?
No.
No, that's what it meant. He was no longer dead.
People are under the graveyard.
Yes, their bodies are. But
even my papa and papa,
right.
They're
my
just bones.
But if they believe
to my house.
But here's the good part of the story. Here's the good part of the story. Jesus told his friends and his disciples that he was going to rise up on the third day. Yes. So would they find Jesus in his tomb when they came?
No.
He told them he wasn't going to be there. He was going to be not dead, but
alive.
Yes. He was going to be resurrected, and he was never going to die again.
Nope.
So here's the big question for you today.
Jesus is a ghost.
He's not a ghost. Is Jesus still alive today, right here? So are we going to find him out here?
Yeah.
No, we're not. So let's go back in here. Come on in, have a seat. We're not going to find him out there. He told Mary and the women that he was and his other disciples that he was going to ascend. Do you know what that means? He was going to go up to be with his Father. But we can't. Can we see Jesus? Can we see him walking in here?
No.
Like his disciples saw him, and the women saw him after. I should shut the door, shouldn't I? The birdies might want to come in. It's cold. There we go. Or the bugs. They're awful friendly, aren't they? So he ascended. He ascended to, and as we say in the Apostles' Creed, he sits at the right hand of the Father. So we can't quite see him, can we? Just like we can't see God. But where does he live? Besides being there, where else does he live?
In our hearts.
In our hearts. He lives right here. Anybody who trusts in and believes Jesus, then he lives right here, and he goes with us. You do?
Yeah.
Then he lives right here, doesn't he? He's right inside you. And do you know what else he puts inside of you?
Love.
The resurrection.
And love.
He puts his love. He puts his life. He puts all of that good stuff inside of you.
Yeah, I eat dinner at my house.
And that's right.
And watch.
So that you can grow big and tall and get to know Jesus better, right?
And
yes.
Strong.
So that's very good news this morning, isn't it? Is that bad news? No, it's good news. All right. And I mean, we love Easter Bunny and we love the Easter eggs, but the reason we celebrate is because of Jesus. So we better pray about that. Let's put our hands together this morning. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you that you didn't stay in that tomb or that cave or that grave, whatever name we give to the place you went when you died. We thank you that the grave couldn't hold you, that the love you had was so strong that you rose up in 3 days. And we thank you that when we love you too, you put that resurrection love in us that makes us strong and makes us able to live with you forever. Thank you, Lord, for these children. Thank you that for their families, and thank you for the fun of this day. Amen. All right, I think it's time to go with Miss Tracy, what you've been waiting for. Yes?
I really don't try.
And you go ahead. Uh-oh. Tracy? I have something in here for each of them. Would you hand that out? Maybe it, not before the egg hunt, maybe after the egg hunt.
Let us pray. Father God, may we come to your world this day with expectation that those ancient stories may once again offer us something fresh and new, a resurrection in our hearts, minds, and lives this day. Amen. Our first scripture lesson this morning is Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. I'll be reading from the NIV. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, 'The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.' Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened." The word of the Lord.
When it comes to the Easter story in the Gospels, this story in Luke may be the one you're most familiar with. But what about the other Gospel stories? There's four of them, and they're each a bit different. And I began to ponder that this week because we're going to read John in a few minutes, and John and Luke don't sound the same. And then I had a revelation this past week. It came through social media. Isn't that amazing? I realized that memories can be kind of sneaky. And I had never, that realization had never become so clear as it was this week. A friend from long, long ago, I haven't spoken to in many decades, put a picture of me and my sister and her on Facebook. And I'd never seen that picture before. Don't you love it when people put pictures of you you haven't seen before on Facebook? But that's another sermon. Anyway, I didn't remember the picture being taken, but there it was. It was on the day we were leaving for a mission trip when I was about, 17, 18, somewhere there, years old. So then, that wasn't enough. She put a picture of everybody that was going on the mission trip on the Facebook page. Well, then it was like, I was really confused. I knew the people all in the first picture, but the second picture, I didn't remember everybody. So the conversation began. Who's that person? Where'd we go? What did we do? And we started comparing our memories over this social media site, trying to piece together the details of what we'd all experienced several long time ago, years. Well, what we noticed in comparing our memories, they didn't match. And some of us didn't remember the memories that other people had. And I began to think we all took four or five different mission trips because we did not look at anything almost the same. It was very surprising to me that after thinking these things and remembering what I remembered and not remembered for so many years, other people had had some that were very different and they weren't the same. But this was just a youth mission trip. What about the first Easter Sunday and the resurrection? That's what stared me in the face when I looked at the Gospels and went, oh, certainly this should have been remembered perfectly. We heard Luke's rendition, which he researched, he said, and he wrote for Theophilus. But let's listen to the story as told by the youngest disciple, and I have to tell you, it's my favorite. But it is the other lectionary passage for today. This is John 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out, and they went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down and looked in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went in the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Well, then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. But for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent in and looked in the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting there where the body of Jesus had been, one at the head and where the other at where the feet would have been. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" Well, she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they've laid him." And when she'd said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Amen. Well, I think you probably noticed some of these details are a little bit different in these two rememberings. It seems Luke did not have the benefit of talking to John before he wrote his account. And there are discrepancies, such as how many women actually visited the tomb that morning. Was it one or five? Or whether Peter, was it Peter that ran to the tomb, or was it Peter and John running and trying to beat each other to the tomb? Did the women bring spices or not? Did the angels appear just to Mary or to all the women? Did Jesus appear at the tomb entrance or later when he was gathered, when he came and gathered with the disciples? Now, I would have thought that those who had experienced this monumental happening of Jesus being alive after 3 days in the tomb would have that event seared into their memories. But after doing a little research in memory making, I found out that I was wrong. That when a memory has a big emotional impact, we may remember one important fact. The tomb was empty. Jesus was alive. But other details are not remembered with the same accuracy. According to Elizabeth Phelps, a memory researcher, the strength of our memory of an emotional event may lead us to think, even to swear, that we remember the lesser details perfectly. But actually the opposite is true. We remember them with less accuracy. This helps me to understand and explains why the gospel accounts are different of this very emotional and life-impacting event. Well, what is it that we know for sure? We know there was at least one woman, Mary Magdalene. She's in all the stories. The stone had been rolled away. There were disciples who confirmed the empty tomb. There were angels who spoke, and Jesus was not laying there amid the grave clothes. Luke reports that the angels told the good news to the women that Jesus had risen, just as he said. But John remembers that Jesus appeared to Mary and invited her to go and tell his brothers, "I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." We may have wondered about the differences, like I wondered why my memories are not the same as others about that mission trip so long ago. But given the research in memory making, it is easier to see why the details may be remembered differently, depending on who you are and where you were in the story. However, what matters most, what remains unchanged, is the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. We may believe it, but I wonder today, do we belong to it? If we truly belong to the resurrection in our own lives today, We need to not just hear the good news this morning and nod and go, yep, she's preaching that same passage they preach every Easter Sunday. Yes, we do. We need to hear those angels and Jesus speaking to us. Why are we looking for the living among the dead? Are we looking for the living? Are we looking for the resurrection, or do we spend our time looking back over our shoulder, looking back at the years gone by, looking at what is dead and gone? If we're living with regrets, remorse, grudges, reiterating those old wounds or our own mistakes that we can't quite get over, it's like living among those headstones I showed the children. Throughout his time on earth, Jesus worked to release people from what was causing death in their lives, or in their bodies even. He helped to release them from their guilt, from the feeling of they were unforgiven, whether it was themselves or others. He tried to release them from their physical hurts. Even on the cross, Jesus offered forgiveness to those who had crucified him. If we belong to the resurrection today, we will begin to live into the Christ. The second question was, why are you weeping? Or why are we weeping? Mary, like the rest of the disciples, didn't remember, or actually didn't hear, I don't know which, or didn't believe when Jesus said he would rise on the third day. I would say we aren't much different. We are weeping because we have not heard the words in Scripture as if they were for us today in our lives. Just like we talked Thursday evening about Jesus' expectation that we should pray so that when we come into a time of trial, we'll be prepared for that time. But there are many other promises and faith-enhancing portions of Scripture that will help us when we're overwhelmed or when we feel like weeping. If we belong to the resurrection, we must belong to Jesus. And that means reading and reflecting, maybe even memorizing, yes, memorizing Scripture, so that it's in here and in here when those days come that are hard and we need more than just our own stick-to-itiveness to get through. And the third statement is a bit different. Go to my brothers and say, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. What is Jesus trying to tell us there? Well, as the disciples came to realize they were more than just Jesus' students, they and we belonged, when we belong to the resurrection, we are his brothers and sisters. He is our connection to God, our Father, as he ascends to be with God. Jesus prayed for his disciples before his crucifixion in John 17, 21. He was speaking of those that he was standing with, but he was also speaking about all of us when he was praying. He said, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. This is the most amazing part of the resurrection, I think. Jesus somehow makes us one. I know, look around at yourselves. You do not look alike. Some of you have lighter hair. Some of you have darker hair. Some of you are tall. Some of you are short. You are all different sizes. You come from all different places. We don't even come from the same faith traditions. We might be here today, but we might come. You might be like me. I grew up American Baptist. We come from all different, maybe no faith tradition before we came here today. And yet he makes us one. Now that is a miracle in itself. See, it's a mystery far greater than our minds can understand. But it can only happen after the resurrection when he's ascended to the Father. If we belong to this resurrection, then we share in that oneness. And we somehow show this glory in our lives. As the Apostle Paul once said, it is no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. That is living the resurrection life to the glory of God. Let's pray. Holy God, our Father, this is the best good news, to know that we belong to you through Jesus, in and through this mysterious resurrection. Because if we belong to you, that means we are welcome, we're expected, we're encouraged, we're at home with you. To belong to the resurrection means life looks different. No longer do those old worries, the old arguments, the old anxieties, the old infirmities of this life overcome us. Praise you, because Jesus already overcame each one. Thank you for inviting us to belong to the resurrection in Jesus. But when we belong to you, there is no other place we'd rather be. Thank you for the invitation daily. The invitation to the resurrection means we pick up our cross and we die to that old life and we become a part of your resurrection. And we're able to live out your love and your truth and your hope and your peace and your joy and all the other fruit of the Spirit. Glory to you, Lord Jesus, because of Good Friday, we can belong to the resurrection today. Father, we also praise you for the wonders that happen all around us. For indeed, there are resurrection moments if we're looking for them. They may be small. We have to pay attention, but they're there. So Lord, today we praise you for Haley's wonderful surgery and for the healing that's in process in many people. Some of them are sitting right here. Thank you for that. We pray for those who are still struggling and are still waiting for the healing of the brokenness that life has brought in them. The brokenness of our sin, the brokenness of the diseases that still lurk about, the brokenness in families, the brokenness in so many different ways. So Lord, we lift folks that are challenged right now by that, that are living in the midst of that trial for your resurrection, for the healing, for the wholeness. We especially thank this morning of Patricia, who is recovering from a heart attack and stents. We think of Julie, who's still struggling with cancer, Marlenus, who is struggling against liver cancer. We think of those who are mourning. We think of Bill Sharp's family, for he gloriously is with you, Jesus, this Easter. But his family is mourning that he's not with them. Lord, we think of those who are in prison and are struggling, but the living with their regrets this day. We lift up those who are in the prison of addiction and their struggles. We lift up those, Lord, who are in difficult marriages, who live in fear for their lives in countries all over the world. We lift up Christians who are facing persecution. We lift up your church, the little parts, the big parts, those who are far and near the body of Christ, wherever it may be, that we would all belong to your resurrection and be one with you and each other, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In and through Jesus, we do pray. Amen. It is now time when we have the joyous opportunity to give of ourselves, to give of our time, our talent, or our treasure. Let's do that now. Thank you. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless you and we thank you for all the ways you've blessed us this day. And we thank you that you let us bring our blessings to you, that you might take them and they become exponential. They will grow in abundance like the bunnies, and they will bring love and glory to your kingdom and make us all one. Amen. Let us say what we believe by this morning using the Nicene Creed, which is on 34, if you do not have it memorized, which I do not. Let us say what we believe. Let us confess the faith of the Universal Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us, I believe we're going to sing, but if I don't look, I will do the wrong thing. Our communion hymn, Please Stay Standing, is 509, All Who Hunger, Gather Gladly. Be seated. This is the joyous feast of the people of God. People have come from east and west and north and south to be here today to gather around this table, just like we will one day when we all meet in glory. That'll be fun. If you trust in our Lord Jesus, you are welcome at this table this morning. And if you, we're going to serve through intinction, so the cups will be down here. But if you, that is not possible this morning for you to come all the way down, we will come to you. Oh, wait a minute. You don't have to move at all. The elders are going to serve you. It's right here in front of me. You see, if I don't follow my script, I get lost. It's how it is. Let's pray. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord, that even when I get lost in my script, you still know what's going on. Thank you that Jesus is alive and death is overcome. Praise you, Father, for this festive feast that reminds us and points us to the great feast. Someday, we will share that with you and all the saints, past, present, and future. Thank you for the bounty of this table from your bounteous creation, for from it we enjoy the bread and the cup, and we praise your holy name. We pray that in the breaking, in the eating, in the pouring, and the drinking, our eyes would be open to know and recognize you, Jesus, and to be present to you this day, just like the disciples on the Emmaus Road. We pray that in the eating and the drinking, Lord Jesus, that we would receive that resurrection life even more and be willing and able and ready to live it out and to belong to it with joy, knowing that it's ours forever and ever. Gracious and loving God, may we be one in you, and through your Son, our Lord Jesus, we would know the oneness that you share, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. To you be the glory forever and ever. We pray this in the name of Jesus as we pray together the prayer he taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At that Last Supper that we celebrated Thursday night, and we celebrate again today, Jesus met with his disciples in that room. And he took the bread that was on the table, and after he had blessed God like we have, he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup and he said, "This cup is a cup, a new covenant in my blood. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim my death until I come again." Let's eat.
Thank you.
body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Cup of salvation. Hallelujah. Let's pray. You fed us and you've blessed us and you've given us new life. You forgive us. You call to us, come out of that grave. Follow me. Oh, Lord Jesus, you are all in all. We bless your name. Amen. I think it's time to sing. Number 238, Thine is the Glory. Let us stand and sing. I don't know where you're headed now. Maybe it's to lunch. Maybe it's family. Maybe it's just to rest. But wherever you go, I pray you carry that love. You carry that resurrection. You carry that glory. You carry that oneness into whatever place you go that others might know it's true. That grave was empty. Hallelujah. Amen.